Top of the seventh here on the Dodgers Radio Network. Due up are Reddick, Tolles, and Kershaw, but they may pinch hit for him. And now, bad clams. Hey, kid, I gotta run to the bathroom. You take over.
No, I mean, I'm just here to change out this piece of equipment. I don't know anything about baseball. Maybe your partner can do it.
I work alone, kid. It's all you.
Okay. There's people wearing blue in the field. The blue guy on the little hill has the ball, and he throws it. He throws it to the squatting guy. Wow, he threw it really hard. And now the squatting guy is throwing it back. Maybe there's something wrong with it. And now the guy on the hill is just holding the ball and looking at the squatting guy, and really nothing has happened. Wait, the squatting guy just stood up and is jogging out to the little hill. And a couple of other blue guys are coming to the hill. And I think the game might be over.
Kid, the game's not over.
Well, isn't anybody on the field gonna do anything? We're gonna be here for hours at this rate. And I forgot to DVR Hawaii 5-0. Wait, there's another guy in blue running in from way far away. And he's taking the ball the first guy on the little hill had. He's just kind of playing catch with the squatting guy. Doesn't anything ever happen in baseball? Can't somebody at least kick a double? And now the guy who thinks Yonder Alonso is a set of directions. Is that funny? Why is that funny? Colin McEnroe.
Well, may or may not be funny, but Yonder Alonso is a player for the Oakland Athletics, and he's the first person I've ever known whose first name is Yonder. But all right, so we're going to talk today about baseball. We're going to talk about two men who have endeared themselves to legions of baseball fans, not only for their own team, fans of their own teams, but fans across baseball. And they've done it in a kind of similar way, by being themselves, by not trying to be much like anybody else. We're going to begin by talking about David Ortiz. He, of course, is ending this storied career with maybe the best last season an athlete's ever had. I think kind of certainly the best last season a baseball player's ever had. I don't know. Our experts may correct me about that. But we're going to talk also about the ways in which he has become almost larger than baseball and what he means to the city of Boston. And then later on, we're going to talk about Vin Scully. Vin Scully, the longtime Dodger broadcaster who decided at the age of 8 that he wanted to be a broadcaster, a sports broadcaster. It is 81 years later, and he's still doing it. How many people can say that? But anyway, he is, in fact, stepping down as well this year. So two guys who are sort of a little bit bigger than their teams and maybe even a little bit bigger than their professions. I can tell you also about Vin Scully that if you don't know who he is, but you watch The Simpsons, every time Harry Shearer does a sports announcer voice, he's doing Vin Scully. All right, so anyway, that is to come. We're going to spend our first two segments on the remarkable tale of David Ortiz of the Boston Red Sox. With us in studio, we try not to do a baseball show ever without Steve Metcalf. He writes WNPR's Metcalf on Music column, but he's also a huge baseball fan and a guy who always has lots of interesting insights. He's like the Roger Angel of Connecticut. And with us also by phone, Michael Silverman, who has covered the Red Sox and Major League Baseball for the Boston Herald since 1995, the co-author of Pedro Martinez's autobiography. Michael, I guess I'm going to begin with you. This is a story that starts for Boston, I think, in 2003. For Ortiz, his career starts earlier than that. He actually played some of his minor league ball a very short distance from where I'm sitting as a Twins farmhand over in New Britain. Maybe for people who just kind of don't follow baseball, which is a lot of public radio listeners, you can sort of just give people a sense. Who's David Ortiz if you don't know anything about him?
Well, he's a guy who used to be called David Arias. And then he changed his name to David Ortiz. That's not the gist of his story. He was released by the Twins for no good reason other than they're a small market team, and they didn't think he was going to turn into anybody. And this is after the 2002 season. And he was a guy who had hit some home runs, and he was very dejected one day. And he was in Santo Domingo, and he ran into his friend Pedro Martinez at a restaurant on the Malecón right there in the Caribbean. And Pedro noticed he was down. He said, "What's up?" And he said, "The Twins released me." And he said, "That's good." And David said, "Why is that?" And he said, "Because I'm going to call the Red Sox and we're going to get you." And a month or two later, David Ortiz had a you know, a very modest invitation to come to spring training, and he nearly didn't make the team, but he did, and he was started off on the bench while the new GM, Theo Epstein, was pretty infatuated with a guy named Jeremy Giambi, who had all the on-base percentage statistics. Well, maybe some of the listeners don't know about that, but the point is he was a failure. David Ortiz nearly wanted to quit, and so finally, with a lot of urging from Pedro Martinez, David Ortiz started to get in the lineup every day, and he began hitting home runs, and that was 2003. And basically, he hasn't stopped doing that till now, here in late September 2016.
So there's a way in which he's synonymous with this this kind of Red Sox era of recrudescence. There's a way, I mean, obviously, they had gone a long, long time without a World Series win, something of a long time without a World Series appearance. And then suddenly, 2004, 2007, 2013, and there's a remarkable season unfolding right now. And there's just no way that you can strip David Ortiz away from all that. This hard luck baseball team, you know, almost a century's worth of hard luck, and he's inextricable from this kind of redefinition of what kind of team the Red Sox are.
Absolutely. I mean, the Red Sox first and greatest period was in the early 1900s, and they had Babe Ruth. They won a bunch of titles, and then after 1918, nothing until 2004. Now you have three titles in, you know, what is it, 9 years, and David Ortiz is the one guy to have three rings. There's no one else like him. I mean, you want to go back to Babe Ruth? That's probably the only one you can compare him to. As great as Ted Williams was, and Ted Williams was a greater player, all-around player and hitter than David Ortiz. The one thing, you know, he only appeared in one World Series, and he never won. So there's a lot. I'd put him right beside Ted Williams on the you know, the Mount Rushmore of Red Sox players, but he definitely has three things that Ted Williams never got.
Right. So, and we're going to talk a lot in the second segment. Rob Nyer is going to join us. We'll talk about statistically who David Ortiz is. But I think another thing, Steve Metcalf, you've been watching the Red Sox for a long time. And, you know, even at moments when the Red Sox were good enough to compete for a chance to be in the World Series, good enough to be in the World Series, they rarely exhibited even the meager amount of joie de vivre that we see from baseball players. I mean, they tended to have these kind of cranky-looking guys like Dwight Evans and Roger Clemens and Pudge Fisk and Wade Boggs. And you could go back to Carl Yastrzemski, who wasn't really cranky, but he was just unbelievably taciturn. He was just this cipher who really didn't talk very much. And there's a way in which that's another way that Ortiz seems to in fact, redefine the ethos of the Red Sox. This is a guy who, you know, on a lot of days anyway, appears to be really having fun and pulling a lot of people into that orbit.
Well, there's no question about that. The more you kind of step back and look at the David Ortiz phenomenon, the more I sort of think, in an odd way, age and maturity may have something to do with that. I just would point out, among the many really interesting things about Ortiz coming to Boston from Minnesota is the fact that he was not a young kid when he arrived. I mean, I think Bill James, the great sabermetrician, has pointed out that baseball players tend to peak between the age of 27 and 28. David Ortiz was 27, in fact, when he arrived in Boston, completely unheralded. You know, he wasn't quite as mediocre as the Minnesota management seemed to think, but you know, his career was undistinguished, I think, at best, and I don't think he hit more than 20 home runs in any of those Minnesota years. But the point is, he was not a kid. He was already, you know, a veteran of 6 or 7 years in the bigs, and I think in some ways, you know, that sort of set him on the path of being that symbol, that clubhouse leader, as they say, that you know, even before his sort of resurgence as a power hitter, you know, I think he sort of cut a figure in that organization that, as you point out, nobody had.
Well, I want to also talk about one of the – I think it's time to step on a few third rails here. I mean, one of them is, you know, and I actually do remember you, Steve, coming back from Red Sox games, I think probably maybe circa 1980, and being – still kind of troubled by, you know, the left field crowd getting on Jim Rice in a way that was really kind of racial in nature. Boston has had a long history of this kind of very steely, chilly problems with race that flare up into bigger fires at times, and that has played out so much in their sports history. And, you know, Ortiz doesn't self-identify as black or certainly not African-American. He's from the Dominican Republic. But there's this way in which, you know, he's probably the biggest, most popular athlete of color since Bill Russell. He may be a more popular athlete than Bill Russell, and seems kind of maybe also to have changed, I don't know, the vibe right there in Fenway Park. I don't know if you want to talk about
that. Well, I'd like to hear Mike talk about that because he's obviously up there a lot more than I am. But, yeah, it's certainly no secret that I think Boston has had this issue for many years, and as everybody knows, was the slowest team in the majors to integrate, and that's a sort of a negative legacy that hung on for a long time. And I do like to think that Ortiz has gone a long way toward dissolving that. Mike, I don't know what your perception is.
Well, yeah, and Michael Silverman also, just to sort of put a modern button on that, we know that Major League Baseball, in a weird way, has gotten kind of less African-American. It's 8% African-American. The Red Sox, which is kind of interesting given the history that Steve's just mentioning, right now I think have more African-American players, including three outfielders and a pitcher, than any other team is carrying on the 25-man roster right now. And I don't know. Maybe you can just sort of react to this a little bit. I mean, is Boston a different town these days in the way that it regards athletes of color? And how much does Ortiz have to do with that?
Well, I mean, it's a great topic because, you know, like we've been saying, there's a stench to the Red Sox franchise from the Yankee era. And Howard Bryant wrote a great book about it called Shut Out, about the history of the Red Sox and race. And, you know, there's a lot going on there. And I can't speak to the city of Boston. I'm sure there are still some folks who don't like the Red Sox, perhaps because they have some people of color on it. But I'm hoping that those numbers have dwindled into nothing and they're you know, living in some basement in South Boston and will never appear again. I think the big change happened, I mean, somewhat in the 90s with Mo Vaughn coming and Pedro coming in 98 was the beginning of that. I think Dan Duquette was the most colorblind GM, the beginning of those, and that's gone uninterrupted since then. And, you know, right now, you know, it's a great blend. African Americans are 8% of Major League Baseball, and that's a story for another day. But I think the Red Sox right now represent some of the best there is in baseball in terms of having, you know, folks from all around the world. You know, a couple, Junichi Tozawa and Koji Uehara in the bullpen from Japan. We have a large contingent of Japanese media. I mean, there's a pretty good melting pot going on in the Red Sox right now, and it's a good time for all that.
There's a way in which Ortiz is kind of bigger than a lot of things, including kind of bigger than rules that apply to other people. And I think this really stood out. And I mean, and part of it is because he's big. He's just a big human being. He's got a nickname of Big Poppy, but he's also this just huge personality. I think this really stood out after the Marathon bombings when he was the voice that people, I think, really wanted to hear at this ceremony. You're going to hear him right now, and we're going to bleep one word of it. But I think that word that we kind of have to bleep in order to keep our license says so much about this, because it's something you wouldn't necessarily use at a solemn, serious official ceremony. Somehow or other, the fact that he uses it, it says so much about how he's regarded and the fact that there was essentially no blowback whatsoever for doing this. So let's hear Big Poppy at this, I should add, televised ceremony.
This jersey that we wear today, it doesn't say Red Sox. It says Boston. We want to thank you, Mayor Menino, Governor Patrick, the whole police department, for the great job that they did this past week. This is our city.
and nobody gonna dictate your freedom. Stay strong. Thank you.
So this is our effing city. Nobody's gonna dictate to us. Steve Metcalf, and I think probably something that is unprecedented in the history of communications regulation, the chairman of the FCC, tweeted, "David Ortiz spoke from the heart at today's Red Sox game. I stand with Big Poppy and the people of Boston," essentially saying in a tweet that he wasn't going to be doing anything about any problems or any complaints he might have gotten about the F word going out live over the airwaves. I might add, I think he's from Braintree. but there's sort of a sense in which this is the guy that, that Boston really wanted to hear. And the fact that he was as visceral and direct and natural in expressing himself was probably a plus rather than a minus.
Yeah, I think so. Actually, it's funny, you know, going back and hearing that little clip again. I mean, we all heard it a million times at the time. It really does now sound sort of almost acceptably defiant and celebratory, even in a way that that word is not always. And as I was saying to you a moment ago, you know, it's hard to imagine any other player, Red Sox or otherwise, using that word in a public utterance and sort of getting away with it. I mean, it's a little hard to imagine Travis Shaw, for example, using the F word in that context and getting anything other than gasps. Mm-hmm. But somehow, you know, David has this persona that I think, you know, it didn't feel threatening. It didn't feel angry or even particularly cursing. It felt affirmative in some Ortizian way.
You know, Michael, this is something we talked about a little bit on Monday in connection with Jose Fernandez's death. But, one of the other stigmas that attached itself to the Red Sox in the latter half of the 20th century was a phrase called 25 players, 25 cabs. I think there's a dispute about who first promulgated that phrase. But there was this kind of the notion that even when they were kind of good, they didn't really like each other that much. It was kind of every man for himself. There wasn't a lot of cohesion. To me, one of the most remarkable moments of this season, I mentioned it on Monday, so excuse me for mentioning it again, but just about a week or so ago at Tampa Bay, Ortiz hit what would be a double, an easy double for most players. He's incredibly slow, but he legged out the double anyway, and he was called safe on a tag by Evan Longoria. They did a video review of it, and then they determined that his knee had come off the bag just from momentum a little bit. He was out. It was a very close game. This would be the kind of moment a lot of players would treat in a kind of surly way. Ortiz's reaction was to get to his feet, fling his arm around Evan Longoria as they ran off the field together, and say something to Longoria that made Longoria start laughing really hard. And there's a way in which not only are these Red Sox not 25 players and 25 cabs, but there's a way in which, you know, Ortiz, particularly in this final goodwill tour, is an ambassador for them to the other teams, too. Nobody seems to have any attitude towards them other than just affection and amusement.
Exactly. I mean, you know, you see behind the batting cage at first game of every series when a new team comes. I mean, you know, at the end of the Red Sox practice and the beginning of the other teams, I mean, it's about a 10-minute love fest between David Ortiz and the opposing teams. Everyone lines up for a hug. He has a laugh, whatever, he's left in hysterics. He leaves them in hysterics. I mean, people just are coming to him. He's an ambassador of love in many ways. And it just, he's always been himself, just going back to, the Boston Marathon speech. I mean, that wasn't a put on. I mean, the guy curses naturally. He does it freely in the clubhouse with the media to his teammates. And it's not any kind of a macho act. It's just, he has a lovably filthy mouth. And he's the perfect guy for this role because his disposition is just, he wants to be loved, and he's easily lovable. You can see it. I mean, that gap tooth smile, it's a big man who's very gentle with kids. And I mean, I've watched the demands on him. They've been incredible this entire season in terms of all the people wanting special time with him. And he's been there. And he's kept his cool. He's very, amenable to everything. And you've seen what he's done on the field as well. So it's a really remarkable story to a pretty special career. And it's been a ton of fun to watch. And there's you know, like you said, the other teammates around baseball, he's truly not just the face of the Red Sox right now, I think, kind of the face of baseball.
Well, I was just going to add, you know, sort of along those lines that I think perhaps David has been undercredited for this, but if there's any player who can be said to have almost personally ushered in the era of hugging on a baseball diamond, it would be David Ortiz. I mean, those of us who go back a ways, you know, as we would try to imagine, say, Bob Gibson or Gaylord Perry hugging a teammate or even touching a teammate is kind of unthinkable. Whereas in the era of Big Poppy, hugging has become almost sort of de rigueur in dugouts and in the Red Sox dugout, I think perhaps in particular, but also on the field and of course very touchingly the other night in Miami when the Mets played the Marlins the first game after Jose Fernandez's death. You know, there was hugs all around throughout the entire evening, and I find this actually very moving and genuine, and I think it's right to credit David Ortiz for this as much as anybody.
You're not going to want to hug after the show, are you?
No.
Yeah,
I mean, no, there's boundaries, Colin.
Yeah, go ahead, and then we have to wrap up. Yeah, go ahead, Michael.
During the pregame ceremony in St. Petersburg that the Rays held, David Ortiz openly wept
right when
they had a moment of silence for Jose Fernandez. And to see a baseball player, or just a male, an adult male, to stand and weep and not be ashamed of it, I think also sends a great message to people all around the country and the world.
All right, we're going to have to take a break here. Thank you so much, Michael Silverman from the Boston Herald, co-author of Pedro Martinez's autobiography. Pedro covered the Red Sox since 1995. We're going to take a break. We're going to come back and look at the numbers. Like, how good is this guy? Is he headed for the Hall of Fame? Why wasn't he? Was he never an MVP? All right, we'll talk about that too.
Everybody tells David you can do as you please, and even the FCC agrees. They would never bleep his vulgarities because he's David Ortiz. He's David Ortiz. Other than when he's not acting his age by destroying.
All right, we're back. We're talking about David Ortiz and a little bit later about Vin Scully, the fabled Dodger announcer. They're both leaving baseball at the end of this season. I can already just say, and this was an easier show for me to prepare for than a lot of the shows that we do, just because I'm a longtime Red Sox fan. There's all kinds of things today that we're not going to have time to talk about. There's a way in which, in all the ways that we sort of said that Ortiz, because of his qualities, the qualities that so endear him, he sort of also is able to skate past some things that might be bigger problems for other athletes. He certainly, his name came up in connection with PEDs a few years ago. I think it's been less of a problem for him than almost anybody else whose name came up in connection with PEDs, because people just, I don't know, they like him in a very different way. Not that it's been no problem. Also, just a couple of things that I would encourage you to take a look at. There's a pretty amazing video, I think it's up on Yahoo Sports maybe right now, of Ortiz pretending to be a Lyft driver. He's got this wig on and there's hidden cameras in the van. And all these people he's driving people around Boston and asking them who their favorite baseball player is. They all say David Ortiz. They don't seem to know that that's him. And he just is having a tremendous amount of fun with it. He is a very funny guy, you can tell. And he's, you know, he plays that for all it's worth. The other quick thing that we won't have time to talk about is maybe one of the few sour notes in this wonderful final season. They tried to have a bobblehead night for him, and the bobblehead dolls came in, and they looked the ones they somehow had been made in a very unflattering way and looked a little bit like those horrible lawn jockeys that people used to have, and they had to. I mean, Ortiz and everybody else connected to it said, no, that can't happen. So, you know, I don't want to put too happy a face on everything. Things go wrong, and there are moments that are not quite as sweet as most of the violins that we're playing here today. But we're very excited now to have with us Rob Dyer. Rob Dyer is really one of the first people to be, you heard Steve mention sabermetrics a little while ago. Rob Dyer, one of the first writers to really popularize sabermetrics and the kind of data analysis, the high-end data analysis that's becoming more and more common today, writing about advanced stats-based ways of covering baseball. He's written a number of books about baseball, including Feeding the Green Monster, which covers the Red Sox 2000 season on a day-by-day basis. And we want to talk to Rob and to Steve Metcalf, who's in studio with me. What we haven't really talked about that much so far is about how good a hitter David Ortiz really is. So So Rob Nyer, I know there's lots of ways to get into this. Are there statistical aspects to the hitting performance of David Ortiz that really jump out at you as kind of special?
Well, sure. I mean, he has been an outstanding – he does the things that we hitters need to do in this era to be successful for the most part. There aren't any. There are very few high average hitters. The Rod Carews, the Pete Roses, the Ichiro Suzukis. Well, Ichiro's still around, but just barely. Mm-hmm. And for the most part, those guys are. That's not what hitters do. Now hitters are expected to hit with power and ideally get on base. And David Ortiz has been outstanding in both areas with a lifetime 380 on base percentage, which is tremendous, and an even better 552. Career slugging percentage.
Right. So one thing that a lot of people look at these days is that sort of the combination of on-base and slugging called OPS. And I certainly this season, at the age of 40, he's been dominating that category, at least in the American League, right?
He leads the American League. And, in fact, this would be the first time in his career at 40 that he's led his league. It really is, and it is a truly historic season that he's having. I think there's a pretty good argument that he's having the greatest season ever for a 40-year-old hitter, at least if you strip out defense, which he doesn't play very often. But just purely in terms of his hitting and what he has contributed to the Red Sox lineup this season, he may be having the greatest season ever.
Right. To that point, yes, he's been a designated hitter. I was thinking about this when Michael Silverman was talking about Ted Williams before. I was thinking, well, Ted Williams didn't play defense either, and he was actually out there, you know? So, I mean, you know, if Dom DiMaggio and Jimmy Pearsall would have been thrilled if there had been a designated hitter and Ted could go and not cause trouble for them. So I want to talk to you and to Metcalf about one of the things that will come up in a little while, and that is whether or not this man is going to Cooperstown. If you watched just this season, heard all of the rhetoric, saw all of the ceremonies, it's just a layup, to use an analogy from another sport. Obviously, this guy's going to the Hall of Fame. But Rob Nyer, does he have the right numbers? Does he have the right case to make?
Well, I think that the standards for the Hall of Fame are certainly in flux right now, as you have fewer older voters and more younger voters, which is going to happen naturally, but it's happening even more now because the Hall of Fame basically excised a number of older voters, mostly older voters, in the last year or two. So it's hard to say exactly what's going to happen for a couple of reasons, I think. One is that if you look at his wins above replacement, which is a number, which is a metric that has gained a lot of favor in the last few years, and it's basically what it sounds like. How many wins did this player contribute above what we call a replacement player, someone you might pick up from your AAA team, your minor league team, or off the bench? His wins above replacement is not that great. Now, there are a lot of reasons for that I could go into, but I won't unless you ask. But it's not that great, especially compared to, for example, another outstanding designated hitter, Edgar Martinez. So that might hurt him a little bit. And the other thing we don't know about is what the voters are going to make of David Ortiz's failed drug test, which did not result in a suspension. And it's terribly unfair in one sense because his test was the only one that was made semi-public among all the other 145 guys who failed a drug test the same year. This is going back quite a ways. So I think it's very difficult to predict what's going to happen. I do agree with you. He will be in the Hall of Fame someday. Mm. I don't know if it'll take 1 year or 10.
Well, Metcalf, one of the things people think about are just also storylines. I mean, maybe Edgar Martinez, the numbers support him better. He may not be associated with quite as much drama. But, yeah, just in general, what's your thinking about this?
Well, I mean, obviously everything that Rob has said is right. But I think the other great unknown in this whole Hall of Fame question is simply the role of the designated hitter. I mean, the Hall has not had to address this question until relatively recently, and I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, Rob, but I think Frank Thomas is the only other player who's in the Hall who has played more than half of his career at DH. Edgar Martinez and Ortiz, you know, a much larger percentage in Ortiz's case, I think something like 87% or something of the games that he's played have been at DH. And I just don't think the Hall has quite figured out what its position, so to speak, on this question is. I mean, speaking as a fan, you know, as much as obviously I admire David's numbers, you know, you have to ask yourself whether a guy who spends most of his career being able to go down to the clubhouse between innings and, you know, lie on the training table or get on the bike or take a few practice swings, you know, is an equivalent accomplishment to the guy who has to go and throw himself around on the field to stop a line drive or something. So I think this is a question that the Hall has to really wrestle with, and I'm not sure that it really has come up yet with an ironclad approach to it.
Yeah, Rob, let's hear your take on that part of it, that whole DH question.
Well, I think that there certainly was a stigma attached to being a DH. I think that's faded quite a bit, if only because almost all of the voters now grew up with the DH. There used to be a large number of Hall of Fame voters who hated the DH because they hadn't grown up with it. It was something that came along in 1973, and a lot of the purists really couldn't stand it. I think most of the voters, the huge majority of the voters now grew up with it and are basically, they don't attach that same stigma to it. Now, it is true, by definition, that you're not, as a DH, you are generating zero value with your glove. And, you know, even a guy who plays first base but not all that well, he's generating some value with the glove because that allows his manager to play someone else at DH or just to put him in the lineup if he's in the National League. So I think that plays into it. The other factor that we haven't mentioned yet is postseason play. David Ortiz has played 82 postseason games. That's half a season. And he's going to play another who knows how many, three or 17 or whatever it might be this October. I think that's a valid thing for the voters to look at, leaving aside the fact for a moment that Ortiz has been done tremendously well in the postseason, but just the fact he's played half a season, I think you can make a case that you have to not only include a player's postseason performance, but you could even argue for weighting it more than you would regular season. So maybe we double that. Well, that's a whole extra season of tremendous hitting. And I think it's a reasonable way. I think if anything pushes him over the top for me, or at least pushes him to the level of Edgar Martinez, it's the postseason performance.
I will make a prediction that David Ortiz is going to get into the Hall of Fame in the first ballot, and it's kind of for the reason that you're talking about, Rob. And here's a clip that probably says it better than any of us possibly could.
K-Rod, and here's David Ortiz. You see that number today with three hits. This could be four. Back it goes. It's over. The Red Sox win, and they're moving on up. Ortiz into deep right field. Back is Sheffield. We'll see you later tonight. Ortiz fights it off center field. Damon run into the plate, and he can keep on running to New York. Game six tomorrow night.
All right. But I apologize, by the way. Some of our listeners say that they have a trigger warning. They want to be told if Joe Buck's voice is going to be played on our show. I'm sorry for there was no warning there. But that was David Ortiz winning three games with three hits in the 2004 postseason. It was his walk-off home run in Game 3 of the American League Division Series to win the series over the Angels, followed by the American League Championship Series against the Yankees, which was one of the reasons it was so hard to get this show produced. Our producer, Jonathan McNichol, is a Yankees fan. We practically had to give him injectable drugs just to get through this show. But, you know, I mean, Steve, there's a sense, and on and on, you know, there's a sense in which There's the guy's numbers. There's the position he either played or didn't play. Maybe there's the PED question. But there's also just the question of the story of baseball. And to the extent that baseball has this overarching narrative, a big part of it, just as the Cubs are going to be a huge story this year, you know, was the story of the Boston Red Sox and what they had and had not done. You know, and he's so intrinsic to that story. I think it gets him in on the first ballot, you know, that plus all the other stuff he's done.
Well, I agree he's going into the Hall, and I think on balance he belongs in the Hall. I think – I'm not sure I agree with you on the first ballot. You know, notoriously the baseball writers, forgive me, Rob, tend to be a little pricky about that, and so I'm not sure that that is a lock for David. But I think he's going to go in, and partly for the reason, Colin, that you just said. I mean, there's a legend – attached to this man, you know, rightly, really, and a lot of that legend has to do with key hits and home runs in postseason moments of high drama. So that obviously counts for something in the minds of everybody, including the writers. But if I could just say one little quick thing before we leave the topic on getting into the Hall as a DH, you know, I do think that there is something to be said for just longevity and stamina and the wear and tear that playing in the field, you know, requires of somebody. And I, you know, I'm trying to think of David Ortiz as a National League player, whether he would still be playing at the age of 40. I think not, and perhaps not even, you know, the age of 35 or 6. I mean, he just hasn't been a complete enough athlete the last few years to do that. So surely, even if you're not a traditionalist or whatever it is, I think you have to weight that somewhere in there.
All right. You know what? I think we're going to take a break here. I don't want to give Vin Scully short shrift. And maybe since we have Steve and Rob here after Vin Scully, we get a quick picture of the drama that is to come, perhaps, in this baseball season. So let's grab a break. We're going to leave off David Ortiz and move on here after this.
Try and stop it with the overshift, but that's not gonna help when the ball just drifts high above the fielders and into the stand. And I said, oh, 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 geez, David Ortiz.
I don't mind talking baseball, but I'm on the Atkins diet, so please nothing about Bernie Carbo. Today's show was produced by Jonathan McPants and me, Kyone Wolf, with help from Joe Nuxhall. Greg Hill appeared in the intro, and the part of Bill Curry was played by Manny Mota. Never miss an episode. They're all at WNPR.org/Colin. On tomorrow's show, the nose wears cargo shorts. And now, back to Colin.
Tomorrow's our culture discussion, our weekly culture panel. And I have to be honest, we do not know what we're talking about yet. I mean, we often don't know what we're talking about when we start talking, too. But that's a different kind of not knowing what we're talking about. We don't have topics yet. All right. We do have topics right now. Rob Nyer is still with us. So is Steve Metcalf. We're going to switch from the field to the broadcast booth of Vin Scully, who, as I said at the beginning of the show, decided at the age of 8 that he wanted to be a sports announcer. It's 81 or so years later. He's going to turn 89 later this year. He is the voice of the Dodgers, if you've never heard him. Actually, we're going to give you a nice big chunk. This is kind of a broadcaster's highlight reel here. One of the reasons we're playing this is because Jonathan McNichol is, as a Yankees fan, so traumatized about the David Ortiz part of this show that we had to sort of give him the Mookie Wilson, Bill Buckner thing to make him feel better.
So the winning run is at second base with two out, 3-2 to Mookie Wilson. Little roller up along first, behind the bag, it gets through Buckner. Here comes Knight and the Mets win it.
One ball and no strike. Aaron waiting, the outfield deep and straight away. Fastball is a high drive into deep left center field. Buckner goes back to the fence, it is gone. For baseball, what a marvelous moment for Atlanta and the state of Georgia. What a marvelous moment for the country and the world. A black man is getting a standing ovation in the deep South for breaking a record of an all-time baseball idol. And it is a great moment for all of us and particularly for Henry Aaron.
Sacks waiting on deck, but the game right now is at the plate. High fly ball into right field. She is gone!
All right. You probably recognize a lot of those baseball moments if you're a baseball fan. I'm not going to parse them all for you, but that's Vin Scully. I read today that Vin Scully, just to give you kind of a time perspective in all this, he joined the Dodgers 3 years after Jackie Robinson joined the Dodgers. So, and I think he announced Mickey Mantle's first plate appearance. He's been around that long. And Steve Metcalf, apparently he's been a part of your life for not quite that long.
Well, just about, though. I almost hesitate to admit this, but Vin Scully's career in the broadcast booth and my career as a living human being on this planet almost exactly coincide with one another. I was born in the late summer of 1948, and some 16 or 17 months later, Vin Scully took over the broadcast booth of the Dodgers. And in fact, some of my very earliest memories of anything that I can summon at this point are of sitting around our family's console radio. God, I sound like Little House on the Prairie here. But, and listening to Vin Scully call the Brooklyn Dodger games. And even now, you know, when I think of those old Boys of Summer names, Farillo and Hodges and Campanella and Snyder and Reese, I think of them as they were articulated by young Vin Scully, and it's just an amazing career, obviously.
Rob Nyer, one of the things that he did, and he wasn't the only one to ever do it, but he might be one of the last to ever do it, is do it himself, right? Everybody has a partner these days?
Sure, and sometimes two, and a lot of broadcasts have a roving reporter in the stands for God knows why reasons. But he's able to carry the game because he's incredibly literate. Obviously, all those years of experience gives him this vast storehouse of anecdotes and memories. And, you know, in a sense, he's a living time machine. It's one thing to watch an old grainy black and white film of Jackie Robinson or the 1953 World Series or whatever it might be. It's another thing to have Vin Scully still alive and bringing those moments to life. And when he tells a story, they're in color, not black and white.
I want to also talk about, I don't know that much about Vin Scully. I'm an American League baseball fan, and so he hasn't touched my life quite as much. But I do want to talk a little bit about, I think one of the things that's amazing about this guy, Steve Metcalf, is that he has stayed beloved by the fans for so long. I mean, it's hard to find anybody ever saying a bad word about him at all. He's almost sanctified. And when you think about how hard that is to do, I think that you and I are on the same page about this, that when, for example, now, this is a former player, not just a full-time announcer, but when Tim McCarver started doing games, we were kind of enjoying, hey, Tim McCarver, he's got some interesting things to say. By the end of Tim McCarver's broadcasting career, I personally was throwing stuff at the TV set. I couldn't stand to listen to him anymore. He kept saying things that didn't make any sense to me. And you just realize how hard it is. The idea that this guy could go that long and nobody has a bad word to say about him, I don't know. Do you have even an explanation for that, Steve?
Well, no, except that I think everybody in the game recognized and has recognized that Vin Scully is just, as they say, a gentleman. He knows the game backwards and forward. You know, he's never been one of these guys that tries to second-guess the manager the way McCarver used to try to do. And, I thought it was very touching, actually. I was watching the game, the last Dodger game at this season, the regular season game at Dodger Stadium, and Yasiel Puig, the kind of fiery Cuban outfielder for the Dodgers, came up to the plate and turned to the broadcast booth and tipped his helmet to Vin. Now, this is a young guy who, you know, I'm sure until recently maybe had scant idea who Vin Scully even was, but obviously has come to share in the respect and the just the deep, deep admiration that baseball people have for this man. And I thought that was a very telling moment.
You know, Rob, there's a truism or a phrase within sports. It's one of those phrases within sports that almost doesn't really have any meaning. But on the other hand, people kind of know what you're talking about. It's called playing within yourself, you know. And there's that kind of sense that there are some players who seem to sort of know exactly what their abilities are and not try to exceed them. At least I think that that's what it always meant. You know, doing the things that you do well, not trying to do the things that you don't do well. What little I know about Vin Scully suggests he might fall into that category too. I mean, there might have been more painterly announcers who've lived. I mean, he was, I think, a disciple of Red Barber, who often was described in those terms. But I get the sense that he's a guy who did the things that he does well, and maybe didn't try to do, as Steve is suggesting, a lot of other stuff that just wouldn't have flown that well anyway.
I think that's right. I don't think that Vin Scully is going to take much time, if any. Breaking down someone's swing, which can be done well by the right people, but often is done poorly, or pitching delivery, whatever it might be. And look, I don't know that Vin Scully is as good now as he was 20 or 30 or 40 years ago. I think sometimes, to be honest, he falls back on the notes that he has for the individual players. If you watch three games in a row, where the Dodgers are playing the Marlins, you might hear the same anecdote three times about a certain player. But the fact that he's able to deliver it in his own style and sound passionate about the game, which he always is. Look, I've listened to some older broadcasters, quite a bit younger than Scully, who sound like they're just beat down by the job and really don't want to be there anymore. And I think one of the keys to his success and his continuing popularity is that enthusiasm for the job never seems to have flagged.
We have a great example of this. There's a guy named Andy Strasburg who concluded that he was a Padres marketing executive, that Vin Scully doing or reciting almost anything would sound really great, just the way whatever flair he does bring to it. So this is Vin Scully reading a grocery list.
Well, let's see. We've got a dozen eggs, a quart of milk, a loaf of bread, a can of frozen orange juice, six small white onions, a green pepper, garlic powder, a package of American cheese, pickles, kosher that is, bananas, cornflakes, maple syrup, toothpaste, paper towels, toilet paper, six bars of soap, hot dogs, quarter pound of chopped meat, steak, lamb chops, package of spaghetti, three apples, bologna, cottage cheese, a pound of butter, two ears of corn, beer, ketchup, peanut butter, soy sauce, and a half a pound of coffee.
All right. Care for some bologna there, Steve Minka?
Well, I just want to say, since I know we're almost done, there's a famous Vin Scully call of a game. It was Sandy Koufax's famous perfect game against the Cubs in 1965, and it's all over YouTube, so it's easy to find. And I would invite baseball fans, especially younger ones, to look it up and listen to Vin's call of the final three outs of that game, which really place you right in the middle of the stadium. It's an electrifying moment. Of course, it's a perfect game, which is always electrifying. But Vin's call of that, I think, is absolutely perfect along with the game, and it's easy to find. So look it up.
Well, listen, I want to thank Rob Nyer. It's such a great pleasure to have Rob with us, so knowledgeable. Maybe we can get him back to talk about the Cubs once the postseason gets going. And Steve Metcalf, we'll never do a baseball show without you. Check out WNPR's Metcalf on Music column. And we're going to end with David Frischberg, of course.
Garvey and Gilliam, Joshua and John, and Juan Marichal was a Dodger too. Even he wore Dodger blue, Los Angeles Dodger blue. And they stayed and they played and they made a dream come true. So here's to the dream and here's to the team in Los Angeles Dodger Blue.
The coach is now running to the pitcher's hill thing, and Let's see if we can read his lips. How am I supposed to read his lips if he's covering his mouth with a mitt? Oh, wait, looks like he's saying, your pitching is fine. I just miss you. Oh, that's great. Coach, you don't have to hide your love. Does that mean the game is over now?